Down County Museum's been very lucky to get some peace for money from the European Union to do a community archaeology dig here on the Hill of Down. And of course, this is a wonderful place to investigate the past, because St. Patrick is said to have been buried here in the 5th century. There was an early Christian monastery here. There's a Benedictine abbey in front of me here. And in fact, the time team came to investigate this area, this particular area, in 1997. They were looking for the round tower just over here. And they also opened up a few trenches in this area, the old tennis court site. And they only spent 3 days here in 1997. They couldn't find the round tower, so it was completely removed in the 18th century. But they did find, we think, part of a Benedictine building. And it was rather interesting what they found. They found a stone wall. They thought it was maybe a rubbish chute of a kitchen. We don't know for sure, but we've got a chance now to spend a month investigating this. So we've appointed the Centre for Archaeological Fieldwork at Queen's University to investigate it for us, with lots of members of the public.
I work for the Centre for Archaeological Fieldwork, based in Queen's University in Belfast, and we're coming up here to carry out what we call a community excavation. We've invited members of the local community up to give us a hand excavating this site here, and just to see what we can actually find. And in that process, we'll teach them how to dig, the process of identifying artifacts, of how to record features, and what to do in the post-ex sort of program of works as well. It's a very valuable thing to do. In effect, it's giving the archaeology back to the people. You know, it's kind of making them, giving them an ownership of their heritage. You know, so letting them be involved as well. We've got our site infrastructure in place, and you can see behind me here we've actually got the first trench laid out. This trench measures 5 metres by 2 metres. We've got an allowance for a second trench measuring 3 metres by 3 metres that we haven't worked out where we're putting just yet, but we're going to leave that until we actually start getting some results from this trench here, and we'll try. We've been here for about a week and a half, nearly 2 weeks. We've opened up two trenches behind me. Because this area is scheduled, we're actually constrained with how much ground we're allowed to open up. So we're taking it very gingerly at first, and just assessing what we're actually going to be finding before we open it up into big trenches. Behind me here, we have one of our trenches located over the remains of what the time team found here in 1997. And as luck would have it, we've put the trench right on top of their backfill, so we know where we are in the whole scheme of things. We've uncovered the rubbish chutes that the time team found in 1997 of the kitchen of the Benedictine monastery. We're getting an awful lot of material culture from that trench. We're getting bags and bags of animal bone. We've had a cursory glance at it, and it seems to be predominantly pig and sheep, with a couple of cow bones thrown in there as well. We're getting loads of seashells, oyster shells and winkle shells and limpet shells as well. So we're getting a gradual idea of what the Benedictine monks were actually eating. As well, in this trench, in what we think are the midden layers, we're getting quite a lot of medieval pottery. The interesting thing is we're actually starting to get quite a lot of earlier material, early medieval pottery, what we call souterrainware, dating to around about 800 AD. And we've also got a quite nice decorated stick pin made from bronze as well. So again, we're starting to get a picture that there's something older on this site that the medieval people, when they constructed these buildings, have actually disturbed. And one of the volunteers, James, today found a lovely piece of decorated slate, what we think might be what we call a trial piece. And these were before the monks were allowed let loose on the nice manuscripts. They used to practice their drawings on a little bit of slate, so we've got one in as well. So we've really got like a checklist of finds when we come out to a site like this, and we're picking them off. Every day we're finding something different. So it's great, it's keeping us on our toes, you know.
All the archaeologists from Queen's are very friendly, as well as the people from the museum, and it's a great day out for all the family. All ages are coming here to the dig. We're looking at what we're seeing here is possibly a site of an abbey and a pit And what we're finding now in the bottom is lots of shellfish and animal bones. We're finding medieval pottery. We've found pins, brooches, rings, and medieval glass.
I actually have a trial piece that I've just found, which is a mould. And there would have been like a ring they would have put in here. 2 more weeks to go until the end of the dig, and I hope to find some more extraordinary artifacts.
We're here at the start of our 3rd week of the excavation here in Downpatrick. We're actually sitting in the main trench that we opened, trench one. And this is the trench that we opened up over what the time team discovered in 1997. Some of the pottery we've actually got are sherds like this. This is 13th, 14th century pottery. You can see a lovely green glaze on it, and it's quite thin, so it's classic medieval pottery in that. But the very fact that we're getting big sherds of it really gives us promise that the deeper we go down, the pottery sherds should be getting bigger and should be getting more plentiful. So as you can see in the trench, we're slowly picking through the layers. I'm just in front of me here are the rubbish chutes of the kitchen of the Benedictine Abbey, and they're leading down into the midden pit itself. What we have done over in the very corner of the trench, we've excavated what we call a sondage. And a sondage is really just an exploratory hole just to see the types of deposits that we're going to have to deal with as we go down. So it's quite narrow and quite small. And it's been really, really exciting because we go down through about 50 centimetres of soil and we've hit another wall. The wall itself, it isn't mortared like these walls are. It's just dry stone construction, so there's a good indication that it is quite early. Now, in the topsoil at this end of the trench, we're actually getting this pottery. This pottery is a sherd we call Sutrian ware, and it's the early medieval pottery. It dates to around about 800 AD. So we have the artifacts from the people here in the early medieval times. And hopefully this wall or this bunch of stones at the back here is actually going to turn out to be the physical evidence of those people as well. It would really be as rare as hen's teeth on this site to find it. We're getting loads of other bits and pieces. This is one of the nicest finds I think we've gotten. One of the volunteers found this yesterday evening. And it's another stick pin. It's actually the second stick pin that we've found on this site. So it's quite simple. It's what we call a watch winder stick pin because the head of it here is decorated just like the little button on the side of a watch to wind it up. But it's made of copper alloy or bronze. You can see it's starting to turn green with the oxidation of the air. But again, that's early medieval in date. This dates around about 900 AD. I love artifacts like this because somebody owned this. Somebody owned it and somebody lost it, you know. You just kind of think back and wonder about the circumstances of that loss and how it's lay in the ground for 1200 years until we've come and retrieved it. So behind us, we're quite fortunate. We've got members of the Ulster Archaeological Society, and I've asked them to come out to carry out a geophysical survey on the rest of this little field here. The method they're using is called resistivity. It sends the little frame, the yellow frame you can see in the background, sends an electrical current into the ground. And the theory behind it is if the current meets something like this, a hard stone wall, it'll come back very, very weak, the signal. But if the current goes over something like a big, wet, deep ditch that conducts electricity, it'll come back very strong. So you see them systematically walking up and down and up and down, and they'll feed the results into a computer program. And hopefully tomorrow, David is going to come back to me with an image of what's beneath the ground. And we can use that for maybe later work if we were to come back. We can make the argument that there's areas over on the other side of the field that need investigated. If there's footprints of buildings that we can see in that resistivity results, we can maybe put a trench over them as well and just investigate them, see what date they are, whether they're related to this activity or whether they might be related to the activity that we found deeper down.
This is stuff we found at the end of the day, and we have to put where it's found. Each layer has separate finds, and those finds are separate dates. So just at the end of the day, we'll put trench one and then the layer or the context number. And this is 118. And a variety of medieval finds from the time of the Dominican Abbey. So we have the base of a very big pot, and there's decoration, and you can see it pie crust, thumb impressed decoration on the base of this pot. And then we have animal bone, and we have pottery again, a nice bit of pottery with thumb impressed decoration, that's human touch. And this bit of metal, which is our first so far, is actually part of probably an iron arrowhead. And you can see the point of the arrow, and this bit here is where the shaft would have gone in. So this is our first military artifact. And so this is the armor piercing for going through chainmail. And we're not quite sure why that ended up in the rubbish pit of the monks, but it's absolutely beautiful. And once we get this x-rayed, we'll get the actual true shape will be there. So that's our first military artifact. And tomorrow morning, we will put all of these in separate bags with the numbers. So you'll have a bag with Downpatrick Community Excavation Trench 118 pottery, and all the pottery will be in that. Another bag for the bone, another bag for the metal. And so this would have been a very, very thriving community of both monks and lay people, in a sense, a proto town. So this is the early Downpatrick, what actually grew into the town of Downpatrick, both lay people and religious.
So here we are at the Archaeology Department in Queen's University in Belfast. It's a couple of months since the digging's actually finished. The trenches have been backfilled and the grass is actually starting to regrow over the trench, so the site has been reinstated. Over the last couple of months, we've been carrying out the post-excavation programme of works, which is we've washed all the pottery, we've washed all the animal bones, we've processed the soil samples, and we're actually quite fortunate we've been able to get some of the undergrad students to do that and teach them the processes of post-excavation works as well.
I'm an undergraduate here at Queen's, so this is the process of extracting the artifactual remains, which is the stuff you can't really see with your naked eye too much. So far what we've found is wood chips here, which show that there are carpentry going on at the site. We've also found here down here is seeds and grains, which we can be radiocarbon dated. Also, there is some fish bones, which show the diet of the people. And quite exciting is the insect larvae, which is quite cool and shows the extent of the preservation that the site has had here at Downpatrick.
So this is skeleton 107 from the Downpatrick excavations. So every individual or every artifact that we find on a site has to get a number, so that then that number follows them through, you know, into the post-excavation phase. So we know where we can link the person back to where they were discovered. So skeleton 107. So you can see we're dealing with an adult. We were able to look at features of the skull and features of the pelvis, and that indicates that he's definitely an adult male, because females, their pelvic bones are generally modified for childbirth, whereas male pelvic bones aren't. So his pelvic bones are very narrow. We were also able to look at his teeth and at different aspects of the pelvis to work out how old he was when he died. And you can see the teeth are very worn, and there's also quite a lot of degenerative changes in his pubic bone and his auricular surfaces at the back of the pelvis. So this suggests he was probably in his middle age, so he's probably between about 35 and 50 when he died. There was also evidence for different types of diseases and injuries in his body. He had a fractured nose, which is quite interesting. It had healed, so you can just see the little tiny traces of the fracture in his nasal bones. He had pretty unpleasant teeth. His teeth were very, very worn. There was evidence of sort of gingivitis, or what we would call it periodontal disease, but the modern term is gingivitis, so a lot of sort of retention of the gums. He also had then evidence of osteoarthritis in his right wrist. So whatever he was doing in his daily activities, you know, was putting stress and strain on this wrist. And you can see that the surface is very polished. So this basically happens when the cartilage between the joints breaks down and then the bones start to kind of rub together and they become polished. So he also then had evidence of degeneration in his spine, in his vertebra. So this can be just related to the aging process, but it can also then be an indicator that he would have had an arduous physical existence. And this is what we'd expect for somebody living in medieval times, because, you know, he would have had to rely on, you know, looking after his animals and, you know, harvesting and growing his crops for survival. So that would have taken a lot of physical effort.
The excavation itself was a very big success over the 4 week period. It really kind of brought the community together and really showed the importance of Cathedral Hill as an historical and archaeological resource. I like to kind of think, even though it was a community-based excavation, we were inviting members of the community in, we've actually almost created a little community of budding archaeologists in Downpatrick, and hopefully, you know, we'll go on to do other projects at the site itself and maybe other places too. So we finished the 2018 excavation in the tennis courts in Downpatrick, and the results were so good and so interesting that we felt a further season had to happen, really just to answer the questions that had arisen through the first season. So we went back in August 2019 for 5 weeks, and we concentrated on the kitchen and the middens that we investigated in 2018. And one of the things I was slightly disappointed about in 2018 is that we weren't able to reach the bottom of the midden pits. That was because the trench was just a little bit too small. So we came back in 2019, opened up a bigger trench, and that afforded us the opportunity to actually get down deeper into these deposits, and it was a fantastic success. We got an awful lot of medieval artifacts out of that trench that'll give us an indication of how the people were living and working in the Benedictine Abbey in Downpatrick. This, in 2019, we also opened up two other trenches, one to the north, and that revealed a potentially early feature. It's potentially a prehistoric ditch that is surrounding the top of the hill. We won't know that for certain until we get the radiocarbon dates back that were submitted a couple of weeks ago. We also opened a trench over in the far east, actually quite close to the cathedral, just on the other side of the wall. And that we put the trench there because it was a very distinct hollow in the ground, and there had to be a reason for the ground behaving that way. So we stuck the trench over it, and we found out that the hollow was actually a filled-in well. And the well was filled in the later medieval period, and lovely artifacts were recovered from that well as well, which is an interesting side story that we're starting to develop for the site itself. So it was fantastic. So the 2019 excavation in the tennis courts threw up an awful lot of wonderful medieval artifacts, and these are really telling us a story. And not only telling us the main story about what life was like, but there's a lot of kind of tangential side stories that we're actually starting to get. If we look at this artifact here, this was uncovered in the well trench over near the cathedral, and it's a piece of copper alloy or bronze, and you can actually see it's decorated with four kind of oblong sort of mounts. Originally, these would have held some sort of a rock crystal or maybe a semi-precious stone. And it would have been attached onto what we call a reliquary. And a reliquary would have contained maybe the bones of a saint or a fragment of the true cross or something like that. Now, the interesting thing with this piece is that the precious stones have been taken out of the strip of metal, and the strip of metal's found itself in the well. So there's a story there that we haven't teased out completely. Maybe it's to do with the dissolution of the monastery in the 16th century, and the soldiers have taken the shiny things away from that and have just discarded a scrappy bit of metal, and then we come along 500 years and actually find it. So at the base of the midden pits that we were able to reach in 2019, it got very wet and quite organic and quite smelly. And that's fantastic for archaeologists because it means that anything organic in it is actually going to be preserved, where on an ordinary site it would just rot away to nothing. And we found quite an awful lot of carved wood and wooden artifacts, and this is one of them here. It's actually a plank of a barrel. So we're very fortunate in Queens that we have a dendrochronology centre here, and these people look at the tree rings of the wood and can actually pinpoint when the tree that made this artifact was actually cut down. So this is the slice that was taken from across the site, and you can see just the little tree rings there. So what the dendroarchaeologist does is plot that into a computer program, and the sequence will actually tell you what date. And it was able to tell us that the tree that made this artifact was cut down in 1197 AD. And the very fact that that is from the very base of our midden pit, it's a fantastic dating for that feature. We know the kitchen would have went up in the 1180s, 1190s. And if we're getting an artifact right in the very base that's dating to 1197, you can't get much better than that. The other thing, the other interesting story that this plank, this innocuous looking dirty plank of wood has told us, is that the sequence that we see in the tree rings doesn't match to the Belfast chronology, the Belfast sequence, but matches perfectly with the Dublin sequence. So the tree that grew, that this artifact was made from, was growing in Dublin and was cut down in Dublin and then transferred up to Downpatrick as an artifact, which is an interesting story. And it's good because it kind of shows Downpatrick's links with wider medieval Ireland as well. The excavation 2019, as in 2018, was very well received. So over the 2 years, we've had just over 100 local volunteers of all ages, stretching from 13 years of age right up to 93. We've had over 5,000 visitors, international visitors from all over the world, have come to actually see the excavation in Downpatrick as well. So it's fantastic, and I really get the impression that what we're doing is putting Downpatrick and putting Cathedral Hill back on the map as a viable historical and archaeological resource as well.